Welcome to They're Going, the Alternative Culture Review. This episode is about Tony Parsons, not to be confused with the novelist. Tony imparts one of the most uncompromising messages of non-duality today. Actually, I like to say that if Tony existed a few hundred years ago, he would have been burnt at the stake as a heretic.
So there is no Ramana Maharshi, just as there is no Hitler.
And indeed, what's both funny and infuriating, for the mind anyway, is that though it is said that he expresses a revolutionary and radical message, he says that he doesn't exist, though a message does get expressed. What's more, always maintaining that that which the message is pointing to is ultimately inexpressible. And that's the paradoxical nature of the non-dual message, something that points at an immediate truth right here, this, but the words can never accurately do that message justice.
This is about childlikeness. There aren't different levels of childlikeness. There aren't different levels of oneness. There is bloody oneness or there isn't.
For a lot of people, trying to engage with the phenomenon that is Tony Parsons is an incredibly frustrating experience. For one thing, at heart, the message is incredibly clear and brilliantly simple. But for those who travel from across London to across the world to listen to him, trying to decipher and understand just what the message is can be incredibly difficult, well, impossible, as Tony himself claims. And there are as many reasons for this as there are people who come to see him. Why do I say that? Because it's the person that gets in the way. What we will be going through, feeling high, feeling low.
Do you ever get the feeling sometimes that you don't know what's going on?
Do I want to ask you what you mean by that?
All this optimism. I was booming and soaring. Things happen like bang, it's this and that, simultaneous. I put out my hand and what do I feel? I know there's a thousand things you analyze every 10 minutes. Patterns, ratios, indexes, whole maps of information. I love information. Eric, this is our sweetness and light. It is a fuck-all wonder, and we have meaning in this world. People eat and sleep in the shadow of what we do. At the same time, what?
A very young child, a tiny child in arms, really, there is just beingness. There is no sense of identity at all. And then what happens with most people is that that beingness, which doesn't identify with anything, suddenly recognises another identity. So it's suddenly an identity, say the mother, appears. And directly the mother, let's say, appears, there's a sudden sense that there's someone here.
So like that's when separation emerges
that's the beginning of separation.
Yeah.
It is not a thought, it's just a sudden sense that there is now someone else in this beingness, in this wholeness. And when there's someone else in this wholeness, suddenly there's someone here. And this is the first identification. And that is the beginning of it, what I call the dream of individuality, where that identification takes place and then there's a sudden contraction of energy which makes that child think that they live in a body and everything that's happening outside them is something else. So that from then on there's separation, and directly there is separation, there is seeking for wholeness again. We will shine, we will fly so
that when you were in your teens, you investigated Christianity, you were somewhere drawn to that for a time.
Yes, I certainly was then a seeker like everyone else. So I looked at Christianity as one possibility the answer to what I was looking for, and spent quite some time looking at that, a few years looking quite intently at that possibility, and then I just discarded it. Because somewhere for me, it was still saying that, that in some way or other, I had to become worthy to be whole.
And that baggage attached to
it, there was a whole baggage of lessons and teachings about how I should become worthy to become everything or to become whole. Yeah. And it just, in the end, just fell apart for me. It just didn't mean anything. So I then looked at other things.
What kind of other things did you look at?
Osho.
This was still in your teens, or this
was
later on?
Well, Osho was later on. Yes, but I looked at Gurdjieff, Uspensky, all of that lot.
Yeah.
I was looking here and there at various different ideas about this.
Yeah.
And then later on, I left my previous life and went to the Osho commune for about 3 years. But near the end of that 3 years, I then saw that in a way, I was still being given a list.
Yes, yeah.
You know, go to therapy, meditate, all the different things that dear old Osho, bless his heart, in a way was recommending. So then again, I knew there was something about that that just didn't ring a bell.
So when you were around 21, I think I read somewhere that you one day you were walking on a park in Balham in South London, and you said something to God, "Show me your face."
Well, there was that intensity somewhere in me, and I was walking across the park, and although at the time I thought I was doing it, in fact there was a noticing that every footstep was uniquely different and never would be there again. That was all that came into me. I wasn't doing that. It was just an idea or a sense that everything was totally new and unique. And suddenly, I wasn't there anymore. So there was Tony Parsons. And there was nothing. There was no Tony Parsons. There was nothing. No experience of it. There was no experiencer. There was just nothing. Bang.
Right.
Or absolute love, if you want. And then I walked out of the other side and I was still a seeker. I was still seeking. And what I now wanted was that.
You wanted to get back to that feeling.
I wanted to get back to it, although I couldn't know it. I wanted to get back to that. So I then went on in various other ways to try and really, in a way, remember or grasp what couldn't be grasped. Much later on, what actually happened was that there was an individual seeker looking for this, and then suddenly there just wasn't.
Yeah.
It was over. There was no individual seeker. And what came out of that was the open secret, and also, I have to say, not for anyone, but the realization that the whole idea that there is something called an individual seeker that has to find something else called enlightenment is totally misconceived. Liberation happened when I was much older, and when that liberation happened, which was the end of there being anyone, any individual seeker, it simply collapsed and there was nothing left.
Individual.
Okay, so as an individual, about a year before this happened, I wrote a great big thick book, which I never published, which was full of lists.
Okay.
It was really talking in the same language. I'm an individual and I, you know, and maybe I can find this and maybe you can. And then I suddenly realized, like the Osho thing and the Christianity, that the whole thing was ridiculous. It wasn't, that wasn't it. That wasn't the answer. I threw the book away and went and played golf. And then suddenly, in the middle of the night, a sentence came to me and I rushed downstairs and wrote it on. But at the same time, I was no more. It was just that I woke up in the night and there was no one.
How many seeming years was this ago, Tony, that you experienced what you would say is reality?
Or 20-odd years ago.
20-odd. Mm-hmm. Was it in a park? I heard you...
No, mean, that was when I was very young. That was only a glimpse.
Right.
Thereafter, I was still a seeker. This was up in Wiltshire when I was living on my own, more or less.
Mm.
Although by then I'd met Claire, who I'm now married to, and she's very much a part of this.
Mm.
You know, in the end, when we'd lived together, this had happened to me. After a little while, it happened to her, and we shared this together with other people.
Wow.
But in that sense, I was just somewhere, and suddenly there wasn't anyone.
Does Claire talk about this?
Oh, God, yes.
Does she talk about
it? But she doesn't talk about it in the same way as I do. She doesn't present it. She comes to everything, and then she talks to people on a one-to-one basis.
Right. What makes you share this and write books about it?
No, nothing. This isn't on a mission. This isn't something that thinks I'm just going to share this with the world. It's what happens.
Yeah.
Or the dropping away of the idea that there was anyone there that could be awakened.
Mm-hmm. Could you talk about that? Or have you talked about that?
It just happens. I mean, there was somebody walking across the park who thought they could be awakened. And then the idea that they could be awakened fell away, and there was being, oneness, whatever you like, you know, whatever word suits. Thereafter, there was still a moving out of being and meing, and there was still someone there with the idea that oneness could be attained, or there could be a preparation in this for that oneness to be more permanent. That was the divine misconception. And later on, apparently later on, there was the beginning of a communication of this in a book called The Open Secret. And as that book was being written by no one, there was a realization that there never had been anyone, and that there was no one who could attain that which already is. Mm-hmm. So then there was what you would call a residing in oneness, but that is inexpressible.
Yeah.
There was nothing left, but life was happening.
When you and I first met, you told me something. You said that you had died once, that you had seen death. Why can't you just let it go? Forget the past.
Unique amongst those with a non-dual message, Tony Parsons is thoroughly uncompromising in what he says, giving no prescription, advice, or practice whatsoever. Who would give such a teaching, he says? Who would receive such a teaching?